thank the jurors for the review today and yesterday. It's been intense, very busy, and I really also like to congratulate phase two student just finished. Lots of interesting projects. I would like to introduce Karl. He's been instrumental in this whole review. He is, he's got lots of different titles. He's got he's an educator, he's a theorist, and he's a writer, and he's also an architect at practice. He teaches at Columbia University. He's got all different titles, I have to read it out. He's a director of Institute of Genetic Architecture at Columbia University, New York, and he's also co-director of Biodigital Architecture Program at University of International Catalunya in Barcelona. And he's also a teacher at Pratt University, or Pratt Institute at Brooklyn in New York. Prior to that, he was teaching at SciArc since 1990 to 2000, where he started using a digital technique to generate all different kinds of possible architectural scenario as well as a project. He's also a principal of METAXY. This is a kind of project, or this is a practice that explores all different possible architectural, speculation based on genetic architectural program. Prior to that, he was a principal of, he's got all different strange names, Oxruno Architectural Practice with Andrew Zagel and Jeff Kipnis. This is 1989 and 1990. And he was also a principal of Excavia from 1992 to 2000. I just asked him, why do you change your practice name all the time? He said, there was a radio station that was very similar to his name of this practice, and people kept calling up for the radio station, so he just had to change. So, because I asked him, is there some kind of philosophical kind of shifting his way of understanding? He said, no, this is just the radio station was bugging him. What is the interesting thing about his way of working in architectural practice is that oftentimes digital techniques being perhaps overlooked or simply being adopted to produce an architectural project, whereas Karl really looking to systemic nature of a possibility of these technique, not only to produce an architectural project, but rethink about the ways in which we operate architectural practice as well as the way in which the society is organized. So he's coming from all different ways to embrace scientific, philosophical, as well as emerging technology into architectural practice. So with that, please join me welcoming Karl.S.Chu.
Thank you. It's great to be here at the AA. Juski, thank you for inviting me. Also, Brett, he said he's coming down. So it's great to be here. Now, just before the lecture, I asked Juski, can you give me a shot of scotch? I said, I need to keep my blood flowing, because otherwise I won't be able to utter any single word that is comprehensible, because I've been suffering from jet lag for the last 2 days. In the last 48 hours, I've been sleeping only 6 hours, perhaps, the most. So be that as it may, that's the life of an architect teacher. So here I am, and today I really enjoyed the last 2 days, the project that I saw with the DRL program, and they're very impressive. And so I'm very happy to be here, and this is, even though a lot of my friends have taught here, including my students, have passed through here, believe it or not, this is the first time I give a talk, and this is the first time I come to the AA for final reviews. So here we are. And today what I'm going to do is to give you a different way of thinking about architecture. I won't be showing too many quote-unquote slick design stuff, which is not to say that it is not good, but what we need is a new paradigm, meaning that we are going through a paradigm shift, whether we like it or not. And that a lot of times you use these tools and techniques and all these complex or sophisticated methodologies, but very seldom do you have the chance to think about what these systems mean within the larger context of, you know, our culture, within the larger context of the history of architecture, within the larger context of the history of ideas and so forth. So we are a very peculiar time in history. And in fact, we're going through a phase transition, literally, we're going through a phase transition. And the world that we are facing in the future is going to be radically different, meaning that by the time you are 50 years old, assuming that most of you are somewhere around 25, 30, you know, the world's going to be exceedingly different. And without saying so, you just might be, if not you, perhaps your children would be the last generation of thoroughbreds Homo sapiens on Earth. And what does it mean for architecture? It's all very well to make these kind of biomorphic shapes, but what the real fundamental problem or not issues about architecture is about humanity, right? So if humanity is going to change, then architecture is going to change correspondingly. So it's not just a matter of being sort of learning how to generate new shapes and forms that are aesthetically pleasing, but there are philosophical, theoretical, architectural issues that are connected to the cultural universe of humanity, and that has a history. So my talk is going to be about some of the fundamental concepts about architecture. What is architecture? That we take it for granted, right? So what is architecture fundamentally? And that how old is architecture? Even though this is not a history class, but architecture is changing. Now, before I sort of get carried away with my introduction, I should show begin to show some images. Unfortunately, I wish we had two screens. I'm going to be showing one set of projects called Planetary Automata. Sounds kind of sort of ambitious. So essentially, you will see that I'm designing planets instead of designing buildings. And I'm saying this in jest, actually. But at the same time, I'm not from a sort of a standpoint of metaphysics, at least insofar as metaphysics of architecture is concerned. So on this monitor, I'll be showing planets generated by cellular automata, specifically one-dimensional cellular automata. And then on the large screen, I'll be showing some of the images and to illustrate what I'm talking about. So perhaps I'm going to let these images run, especially the one on images of planetary automata, which is based on one-dimensional cellular automata. And they're altogether a total of 256 rule sets. And so there are altogether 256 planets in this solar system. And I'm going to keep it running as a loop. Okay? And each planet is a consequence of after 300 iterations or generations. I wish we can do more. There are a number of logistic and pragmatic problems of generating, say, 10,000 generations. I will have to do that. But anyway, I just want to show you that these are planets. And this is another way of thinking about architecture, and that now we are sort of moving towards kind of a world, a global brain paradigm, where the internet is but just the first order of manifestation of the interconnection of all these, you know, servers and nodes. So, okay, I'm going to turn this computer on, monitor on, and then I'll start my lecture. Which I'm sure is very different from what you've been hearing of late. All right, the planets are on. Some of them are minimal, almost nothing there. Too bad that I couldn't ask people to raise this monitor. Be that as it may, here we go. Can you guys see the planets? So-called planets. Okay, the title of the lecture is quite ambitious also, Ontology of Genetic Architecture. But what does it mean? And what is genetic architecture? And what is ontology, by the way? Ontology is a philosophical term, and essentially it has to do with the concept of being. Being is the most fundamental concept in philosophy, because being is a category that addresses everything that exists. And architecture, because something exists, right? Essentially, for instance, I don't know how many of you know philosophy. The grandfather of Western philosophy is Parmenides, the pre-Socratic philosopher. He's the first guy who says that being is and non-being is not. And so any architecture that you come up with is essentially a subset of the concept of being itself, whatever that is. In this case, being is a comprehensive notion, right? In fact, one of the largest notion that the human mind has come up with to address the concept of existence. So being encapsulates and encompasses everything that exists. And that architecture, of course, is a tiny subset of that existence. And here, so ontology addresses a philosophical concept of, you know, the nature of everything that exists in sort of general terms. And here, genetic architecture is a subset of that. or rather, depends how you interpret genetic architecture, or rather, depends how you interpret the concept of genetics. And mind you, my notion of genetics, in fact, genetic architecture is a term that I coined in around 1993 or so when I was teaching at SARC. And of course, at that time, the concept of genetic was inspired by biology, DNA systems and so forth. But at that time, even from the very beginning, I was not interested in imitating biological systems, much less, you know, try to imitate the DNA structure and to emulate an equivalent structure in architecture. But the term genetic is much more fundamental than the term as it is used in biology, even though the term is derived from or coined by biologists, specifically, in this case, Johansson is a Dutch, Danish biologist around the turn of the early part of the 20th century. He coined the word gene, G-E-N-E. And we take it for granted that this, you know, genetics is a sort of, is there within the cultural universe. But that term was coined by Johansson in 1905 or so around the time. Basically, it talks about a minimal unit of self, a unit of heritage, a unit that carry sexual hereditary information. And genetics is the term coined by William Bateson in around more or less about a year or two after that, around 1906 or 1907, which refers to systems that propagate hereditary information. Okay? So these are abstract concepts. You don't necessarily have to refer to biological systems, DNA systems, to talk about genetic architecture. So from the very beginning, my intention is to develop a concept of genetic architecture. No doubt this concept is implicit within the history of architecture itself, but it has not sort of been made explicit, meaning that insofar as, you know, propagation of hereditary information is concerned, there are other kinds of ideas, not just biological systems, that tradition passes down over time throughout history. So that without any kind of a propagation of these kind of a hereditary information, we would not have a concept of knowledge, we would not have the concept of culture, tradition, and so forth. So these are terms that also, without a very clearly defined concept, human culture passes down throughout history, and then we carry the knowledge and information to construct architecture, to develop new ideas, to interrogate, to research new possibilities in science and mathematics and so forth. So intrinsically, culture is genetic already, and especially in physics and mathematics, it is intrinsically, even more so, it is fundamentally genetic, because you are taking from handed down information and developing it further and pass it on to the future. So my concept of genetic architecture is a non-mimetic concept. It's not dependent on biology as such, and I'm calling it a philosophical genetics. And as you may already have a sense that this lecture is not a typical architectural lecture, it is mixed up with design, theory, and philosophy. And I'm right now still developing the concept, and ultimately I'm trying to weave that notion with Leibniz's concept of monadology. Leibniz is a German philosopher, 17th, 18th century philosopher, who came up with the concept of the monad. And so I'm trying to translate the concept of the genetic into a concept of a monad. And I will talk about it a little later. And of course, ultimately, architecture is the construction of whatever definition that you may have about architecture. Doesn't matter who you work for, whatever software program that you use, whatever kind of shapes that you have a predilection for. But ultimately, we can agree upon one thing. Architecture is the construction of possible worlds. Okay, so it is about world making as such, in the most general sense of the term. And when I speak about the term, the word world, the construction of possible worlds, I don't mean the universe as such. Of course, it is also pertains to the universe, but a world is any ensemble, any kind of organization that are more than two or three things and how they are connected together so that it can be as small or it can be as large as the physical universe itself. Or it can even exist as a mathematical construct, or it could exist, a possible world, a virtual world, could also exist within the virtual universe, so to speak, right? So I want to expand the concept of architecture far larger than what you're accustomed to, what most schools of architecture, including Columbia, Pratt, and elsewhere, teach you what architecture is. And on that question, I'm also interested in what is architecture, right? And I'd like to ask you, in fact, I didn't have the opportunity to ask you, for those of you in DRL program today, I suppose you guys are graduating, I'd like to pose to you, what is architecture? Is it fluid dynamics? Is it a certain type of use of morphology? Is it a certain type of shaping? and quality, right? So I think architecture is, to be an architect is not an easy enterprise, right? And architecture is even much more complex. So to that extent, I think one can interpret in a general sense that architecture has to do with the construction of possible worlds, whatever that may be. And in fact, there are infinite number of possible worlds. 100 years from now on, 1,000 years from now on, 2,000 years from now on, we will have different knowledge, different technology, different set of criteria, right? Different set of social existence. And then at that time, at that moment in time, our conception of architecture will be different also. Just like it was different for the Egyptian time, back in history, back in Chinese civilization, Mexican civilization, and so forth. Every civilization has their own cosmology, so to speak, right? And that has to do with architecture. And it is in that context that you choose to dwell, right? It is in that context that you choose to construct objects, artifacts, houses, buildings, cities, and so forth. I'm a little... Okay, because that's a concept that is very broad, and for me it's very... There's nothing better than silence to take a pause, right? Whether one chooses to or not. Because the concept of world... Maybe that should be the end of architecture. It ends with architecture. Can we have more scotch? So, as you can have a, oh, he's make it vodka, actually. You know, the best tequila I have was in Mexico City. And, you know, it literally put you into a different space. And that's architecture, too. So architecture extends from, you know, the space induced by substances such as tequila, scotch, vodka, whatever you, to the outer reaches of the universe, right? To the most esoteric and abstract concept of being. And here we have an image of Hercules. I'll try to keep it short, okay? This lecture is like endless because the concept, the ideas are endless and they're intertwining to each other. And hopefully by the end of the lecture, I would have managed to give you a sense of the world of these ideas, the world of these projects, and how they interrelate with each other. And this is Hercules holding Atlas. And this is precisely the responsibility, partially, right? Well, this partially is the responsibility of the architect. Because if anything, architect has to do with it, you know, the construction of possible worlds, as I mentioned earlier. And the term architecture, the English word architecture, which has its origin in Greece, is of Greek origins. I don't know, I taught many schools, graduate schools, you know, graduate students, and one of the first questions I asked first day of class is, what is architecture? You know, however you choose to understand it. Okay, just tell me literally, what is the etymology of the word architecture? Maybe two out of 10 have some idea, but mostly they don't. And it's not the fault of the students. Yeah, there's architectures here. The substance of architecture, right? So, but coming back to the term, it's a Greek term. Composed of two terms, two words, archai and tecton. Archai is a term, is a suffix that is shared by numerous words such as archetype, archaeology, anarchy. So if there's anarchists in this school, then you are essentially anti-architecture. And the word archai in Greek means that it pertains to first principle. In this case, first principle meaning not just physical laws, but of course it's laws, the laws of the universe, but more appropriately, it's some kind of a metaphysical principle of some kind. At least that's etymologically, that's what it means, archai. And tecton has to do with craft making. It has to do with, it came from the Sanskrit term tekma, has to do with the carpentry, the use of wood, the working in sort of crafting with wood, and that's where the term builder came into being. So architecton in Greek means a builder who built according to first principles. Now that's a loaded term. And also tecton is connected to another Greek word called techne. I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Techne also is, you know, the etymology, the root word for technology, technique, method. So the three terms are kind of incomplete with each other. Building based on certain methodology, deploying first principles. And according to Heidegger, the late Heidegger, he says that it's a disclosure of being itself. And of course, Heidegger is sentimental and poetic and try to use, you know, his sort of his phenomenological approach to architecture through kind of uncovering of the truth of being. But we don't have to go so far. But for now, all I want to say is that yes, architecture is the construction of possible world. World, the concept of world has no scale to it, okay? It's just a concept, any kind of ensemble. And it is in that context that we find some kind of a construction, some kind of organization, right? And insofar as they come together in some kind of cohesive, consistent manner to create some kind of possible reality, so to speak. And lately I've been reading on, I don't know, maybe some of you have been reading to Alain Badiou, which opens up another terrain for me, at least for architecture, his concept of the generic, which is non-computable, non-constructible, which makes me think that what are the limits of architecture? Is architecture so far defined primarily within the domain of the constructible, the computable, right? Because even when I said that architecture is the construction of possible worlds, I'm already taking for granted that it is something that can be constructed. But of course, in the profession, and for most people, for most architects, for most builders, architecture, you're not an architect, especially in some countries in Europe, you're not an architect until you build. That until you know matter, you know material systems, you know all the complex processes that's required in the construction of a building, which no doubt is extremely complex, right? But at the same time, Badiou at least has opened up for me the very limits of constructibility. And in mathematics, you have this concept of constructibility and non-constructible sets. You can conceptualize these generic sets that are non-constructible. So that concept of genericity is quite different from Kohler's notion about generic, which is generalization of a type of object having some similar properties. But whereas in the case of Badiou, the concept of the generic is the non-constructible. In fact, generic pertains to the infinite. And of course, in the case of Badiou, he drew inspiration from set theory. Set theory is founded by the mathematician Georg Cantor in the late 19th century. So what it opens up for me is that constructibility is defined by the limits of computation. What is computable is not necessarily the same thing as what is constructible from a set theoretic standpoint or other spheres of mathematics. And in the case of set theory, especially in this case, the continuum hypothesis, you know, we're dealing with generic sets, abstract esoteric sets, but they're logical and they're consistent, and they're part of the domain of knowledge itself. And so I don't know where the limits of architecture are, even though earlier on I just said that the architecture has to do with construction of possible worlds. And the notion of possible world is first introduced into philosophy by Leibniz, who also introduced the concept of the monad, monadology. And if you guys want to expand your concept, the abstract concept of theoretical notions about architecture, I would suggest that you read monadology. And this is precisely what I'm trying to do, to come up with a computational monadology, you know, based on the concept of genetic architecture, using genetic architecture as a way to construct possible realities or possible worlds. And so I would like to expand the concept of architecture very big, very large, almost infinite. So the concept of architecture, if you incorporate Badiou's concept with the generic, really opens up towards the infinite. But if you don't incorporate the concept with the generic set of architecture, then you are working within the domain of the constructability of architecture. And especially if you're using computation, you are limited to the limits of computation. And what is that? What are the limits of computation? And that's another completely whole new sort of area. Because what is constructible, all these images that you see on the board, right, has to do with things that are, of course, at this stage, you are the designer, you are the architect. Your decision, your disposition, your desire, your interest has a lot to do with the shaping of these objects. And I'm using the word shaping in a very so precise manner. I'll explain to you why I usually use the term shape as opposed to form making, as opposed to shape making. Shape shifting, whether you're using dynamical systems or what have you, but you are modulating these systems in such a way that it arises to some level of organization whereby you find it aesthetically interesting and also it responds to the site and program, so forth. As opposed to having a kind of organization which has its own internal propensity to come into being, just like in biological systems. Right? So biological system has a high degree of interiority. And maybe perhaps here, as you probably have a sense now, my lecture or presentation or discussion with you or sharing this conversation, because sometimes lecture seems a little bit too arrogant, is that, biological systems, right, biological organisms, species, have a high degree of interiority. And of course, traditionally in the medieval times, and even up to for some people, the concept of soul has a significant, is a significant term. The soul is that which characterizes interiority, so to speak. But lately, for the longest time, of course, I was quite suspicious of these kind of medieval terms. Soul, actually, it's not medieval, but it goes all the way back to not just Greek, Egypt also. With the concept of soul defines the internal, invisible interiority of a being, right? A being that is alive. And at this point, now that I brought the question of life, I have to augment the definition of architecture with the definition of life. Not that I'm going to give you a definition, but the concept of life. Let's say that, okay, the universe is prolific in terms of self-generation and self-organization, self-propagation, and do diverse kinds of things in the universe, right? From quasars and solar systems and planets and all kinds. Not to mention black holes. But is that architecture? Now, closer to home, let's say that, okay, what about ant farm? What about beehive? Is that architecture? What about in chemistry, table of elements, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, what have you, nitrogen? Are these architecture? Because they're self-organized, right, structures. They're emergent structures of the physical universe. So where do we define the limits of architecture? Because these are organizations. They have meaningful structures and properties. And they interact among themselves to create yet other emergent structures. So then we need to find some kind of a limit. I tend to think that, of course, in the general sense, if I incorporate especially Badiou's concept of the infinite, the generic set, then architecture is both organic and inorganic construct of some kind. But if you incorporate the generic concept of the generic, then you extend out to infinity. So you extend the concept of architecture beyond the limits of the constructible, so to speak. But now, if we incorporate the concept of life, that's a whole different ballgame, right? Because when we design a house, what are we doing? We're designing a set of living facilities. You are designing for life. That architecture is, according to Le Corbusier, a machine for living, so to speak, literally, right? So then you talk about whether architecture is for life or that architecture incorporates conditions that are outside of life itself. My own personal opinion is that I'm not sure. It's undecidable. That architecture can also exist outside of life, that architecture can also exist within life itself. And when I say life, I don't mean just human life. Life as such in the universe, the phenomena of life. And that even biologists has not come to clear terms of what life is. So I don't know what life is, that when you see it, you know it. Okay, so I'm not a specialist in about the phenomenon of life, but we all have a sort of primal, primitive concept of life, or rather a sense of life. So let's just stay at that. So if you define architecture in terms of life, in terms of human life, then the tendency of architecture up to this point in time, all the way through from the very beginning of architecture to now, is that architecture is a subset of anthropology, as this image shows. That architecture is man writ large. That architecture is the extension of man, Homo sapiens. That architecture, we need architecture because we need to survive, that we need all kinds of accommodations, from houses to buildings to cities, not to talk about politics and socials and, you know, sex and what have you. That architecture is in response to human activities. I hope you bear with me. I'm sort of, as I'm speaking to you, I'm also thinking for myself in some primitive terms, terms that lead me to other terms. But in general, I have, you know, agenda what I'm going to talk about today. But the question of life and its relation to architecture is one of them. And that some of you may think that these are so trivial that we all take it for granted, that you don't think for too seriously for a minute. But part of the reason why I'm talking about this is recently I've written on the topic an essay for Log magazine in New York, edited by Cynthia Davidson, for the issue, the latest issue on meta critique. So, okay, Cynthia, I'm going to write about what is architecture. I've written about four or five versions, and I told Cynthia, I cannot submit it. I'm not happy with it. And after writing about four or five different versions about what is architecture, which is supposed to be very simple, right? I've been in architecture for the last 20 years, and I should be able to write it in one night, one evening. But I find myself that it's quite difficult. And which also reminds me of Deleuze, I'm sure most of you know. He wrote one of the last books called What is Philosophy? And it's a subject that only, you know, a philosopher at his old age can reflect upon things and then kind of give a summary of his own experience about what could be philosophy for him. And I think the same thing is true. Right now you are in school, you don't think about what is architecture. All of us know that everybody have experienced architecture, but very, very few people has taken the time and chance to interrogate into the question of architecture. And I've been thinking about this term for quite some time, even before I started writing this paper. And so, but I've come to certain conclusions, one of which is the architecture is the construction of possible world, and that so far up to this point in time, architecture is a subset of anthropology, or what the Italian philosopher Giorgio Agamben calls an expression of the anthropological machine. And so architecture, to that extent, is a mirror image of humanity, is made in the image of man, so to speak. The minute you impose your aesthetic sensibilities, the minute your desire is operative, the minute you make certain selection criteria, right, you impose on to the organization of certain kind of whatever program or whatever you, or architecture or systems, you are essentially interfering with potentially innate properties of what the system is capable of. In other words, we are domesticating the system according to the substance of humanity. And to that extent, architecture, yes, is an extension of man. And even these issues are addressed by Plato. He says that man is the measure of all things. And definitely, architecture is a subject of the concept of the man, you know, man being the measure of all things. But Louis Kahn thinks quite differently. He was always thinking about the immeasurable. You know, he asked the brick what the brick wants to be. It wants to be an arch. It may sound too trivial and poetic to us, right? But where in fact, it is the same thing with genetic system. You ask yourself, what does the system want to be? Let the system be. Let the system itself organize itself, as opposed to you constantly interfering and modulating the system with all kinds of parameters and criteria and constraints from the outside of the system in order to for the system to arrive at some kind of a configuration that you think is interesting. And we're doing more or less, if I'm sort of exaggerating a little bit, the way we domesticate animals, pets, dogs, cats, right? So we're domesticating it. So that implicitly, ethically and morally and philosophically, there is a kind of a master-slave, what Hegel would call master-slave relationship between architecture and man. Because it is for the function and use of man. And I would like to say that we have arrived at the point in history where these notions cannot be taken for granted too casually. Here's my third slide. But the last set of 50 slides will go very, very fast. I promise you, unless I need another vodka. So again, yeah, this image signifies for the architecture, especially during the Renaissance time, and especially for someone like Palladio, that architecture is a reflection of man, right? The dignity of man. But here, just tracking back a little bit, yeah, but in the 20th century, we have just discovered all kinds of things, right? We know how to destroy nature. We know we have harnessed properties of nature, hydrogen bomb, right? And this is from Los Alamos. And then we have discovered in only about the 20th century, the DNA code, embryology. So we have made profound discoveries in the 20th century. And then if you look back at the history of architecture has always been influenced by discoveries made in mathematics and science, and of course religion also, right? And because technology, which is an extension of science, provides you with means of construction. Mathematics and science and technology provides you with new methods of construction for new kinds of materials. And then we incorporate these materials based on our own interests and based on our own necessities. And then we deploy them into new kinds of architectural morphology and so forth. But now in the 20th century, we discover another type of system, genetic system, generative system. And then for the first time, explicitly for architecture, I think genetic systems are crucial. I'm not just saying that it is crucial and fundamental and significant because I coined the term, but I think it is an intrinsic property of nature. It's an intrinsic property of nature itself, genetic systems. And by that I don't mean just biological systems. In fact, the term genetic is used in one of the most esoteric mathematical disciplines called set theory. They talk about genetic construct of set theory, of sets. And likewise, we can also talk about the genetic construct of architecture as such. So my point is that, yes, the construction of possible world has to do with the method and the logic of construction. And that to that extent, genetic is fundamental in terms of constructing some sort of higher orders of emergent organization of some kind, whatever that may be. And also the concept of matter is also in the process of transmutation. And now there are materials research laboratories in the United States, and I'm sure elsewhere too, have found new kinds of matter that nature has not given rise to, right? By harnessing the properties of nature that we are able to construct and define and give rise to some kind of new kinds of emergent novel material properties and so forth. So imagine what the future is going to be like 20, 30 years from now on. And I'm not, by speaking these terms, I'm not trying to predict what the future is. But see, architecture has a responsibility to the present, of course. Like in the case of Kohlhaas, it's all about present. It's very little to do with memory, the past, right? Dealing with problems that are contemporary, globalization, economy, politics, and so forth, and that you address these issues based on these data and facts and statistics and so forth, the migration of people from Mexico to United States, from China to Timbuktu or wherever you, and then you come up with this kind of a packaging of architecture, right? Whereby then you discuss how everything's related in terms of the flow of people, the flow of money, politics, the inversion of semiotic meanings of the iconography of building and so forth. And then you present it to the culture of the universe, which is no doubt one significant approach. But it doesn't address the concept of genetic architecture. It doesn't address the concept of interiority. And what the concept of genetic systems does is that it addresses the interior logic of coming into being, how something is made from within itself, as opposed to purely relying on external forces that modulate and shape and form, and organize some kind of amorphous substance, right, into all kinds of intriguing, aesthetically pleasing buildings. So one approach is that the locus of motivation comes from outside of these buildings, right, external criteria, whether it be context, whatever system that you're deploying, motivating systems, especially in this case, dynamical systems, right? Because dynamical systems, the only thing that it does is that it exerts forces from outside. at the end of the day, is nothing more than just morphing, a very complex and sophisticated way of morphing and shape-shifting in order to arrive at the kind of result that you wish to see. Whereas in the case of genetic systems, it's come from within itself, right? If you look at any kind of a species, so different processes involved. Of course, at the level of genes, there are internal dynamics and sort of operative within cells, no doubt. But nonetheless, the DNA system, there's no organism without the DNA system. And in fact, 90% of the majority, let's put it that way, of living species on Earth is based on the paradigm of the DNA system. And that only recently we have discovered that maybe perhaps 15, 20 years ago, a subset of genes within the DNA system called the Hox gene or the homeobox gene that is literally responsible for morphogenesis, all the various organs and body parts of an individual species. And another astounding thing that we have discovered is that we, meaning the biologists, that the same system operates at different species also. Can you imagine coming up with an equivalent system for architecture? That it is only for the first time now that we can begin to think about such concepts. And I take it seriously. And there's no precedent. And I'm talking about genes and memes, and memes is the concept introduced by Richard Dawkins, right? Any kind of unit of cultural information that is passed, handed over, or through interaction of people. And that's also genetic of some kind, but in this case, a concept that has been replicated through rumors and through media and through telephone channels and through blogs and so forth. Right? That's another kind of a dissemination of information through kind of interactive exchange. And coming back to concept of time, earlier on I was making reference to the point that Kohler's is highly focused on the present condition of the economy and politics and so forth and architecture and the expression of that system. And of course he's intelligent, one of the most intelligent architects, even though I'm very critical of him, for reasons that I'm talking about here, is that then, you know, architecture is a modulation of capitalism ultimately. It's an expression of capitalism. But of course he's intelligent enough to invert that logic of capital itself. But inversion only through semiotic inversion. But he is Derrida called, you know, someone who, an agent who deploys the concept of desistance, neither assisting nor resisting, but operating down the middle, negotiating very sort of precariously. And he's one of the best. But in order to do so, because an architecture operates at the level of human interaction, so there's no, very seldom that do we have the capacity or time for practicing architects to deploy genetic systems, which is highly complex and highly tedious. At this point in time, there's no precedent for architecture from a methodological standpoint. I cannot sort of pinpoint you or sort of give you reference to, okay, look at the software program. It has a built-in genetic software. No, there is none. In fact, there are a lot of software programs that utilize dynamical systems. That's why it has become quite rather relatively easy, I'm not saying that it's all that easy, right, to deploy dynamical systems and parametric systems, because these are engineering software systems, and that a lot of modeling systems has these features. By the way, this is the moon. And I show that intentionally, why? Because I'm designing planets, so and this is a model. When I say planets, excuse me, okay, I'm just not literally designing planet, but it's a kind of a symbolic metaphor for the concept of world. Okay, so having said that, right, the concept of time is intrinsic to the concept of the construction of a possible world. As you know, I'm trying to weave my concept both back and forward and front. And so why that is the case? Because historicist architecture, historicism always deals with the past. Right, modernity, the heroic stage of modernity, deals with the progressive nature of culture and the forward movement, right? At least they are propelling towards the future. And they could come up with these heroic gestures in architecture. And strangely, at this point in time, historically, this is a consequence of history, right? We are sort of the latecomers, mannerisms, right? Especially people like Kohler's, mannerist architect, and Venturi too. They can reflect upon and reappropriate retroactively what has happened to modern architecture, and they become cynical and critical, and for good reasons also. But at the same time, they're incapable of proposing what the future might be like, or could be like, or should be like. And that is the ethical imperative. Ethics deal with what should be the case, what ought to be the case, rather than what is the case. And in the case of Kohler's, what is the case, that architecture is a reflection of what is the case, that one engages critically and intervenes into the matrix of social, political, economic dynamics and inverse systems while at the same time incorporating and making capitalism, which is a very complex history, you know, meaning that complex, the history of capitalism goes all the way back to England and Holland, Dutch. So don't think that these architects are purely based on some of the pragmatic and so concerns. They are motivated by sort of maybe perhaps sometimes conscious and sometimes unconscious motivations about where they are from. And part of the necessity to be a good architect is to be able to exceed and transcend, you know, where you come from and the limitations imposed by the past, so that you can look forward to the future for the construction of possible worlds, right? So it is in that context, the architecture is conceived in terms of the construction of possible worlds that one has to address, be cognizant of the concept of memory, the present, and the future. And one of the best examples of the definition of the present is that the present is the intersection of possible past and possible future, so that when you're designing, you're not completely oblivious to the past, nor are you completely oblivious to possible futures of architecture. And not just, of course, when you're designing, because you have to be optimistic to be a good architect, you have to be hopeful, so to speak, right? You have a future to live as an architect, you want to be successful, so with the kind of ideas and motivations that you're already directed and intention towards the future. But mind you, but when it comes to, especially in school, you can afford to do that, but when you're out in the world, it's not so easy, right? We all know that. But on the question of the future, on the question of time, right? William Gibson, I'm sure all of you know, he says that the future is already here. It's just that it's not widely distributed yet. It is true. The future is here already, that is not widely distributed yet. And what does it mean? And according to another computer scientist by the name of Alan Kay, he said that the best way to predict the future is to invent it, not to shy away from it. And to ask yourself, to what extent are you designing based on some kind of a sort of unconscious eclipse of a possible future, and that you are simply addressing problems that are present at hand, right? Issues that are at hand. Because if you go outside of that, people begin to say, and I myself have been accused of being sort of irrelevant, dealing with issues that are irrelevant, utopian. And there's a need for utopian imagination. And so it is in that term that I'm trying to define the construction, architecture, the construction of possible world from with a utopian spirit. And not so much, of course, you know, one has always to deal with the constraints of present, but not so much just responding to these presents, the constraints of the present, but also to provide indications, possibilities for the future. And not just inventing new tools and new methodology, new ways of fabricating, new ways of designing, new morphology, aesthetically pleasing, what have you. We've seen, if you look at the magazines these days, you see them all. There's a whole catalog. And that the project that you do, I'm sorry to say this, will be part of the catalog. In the 20 years, 30 years from now, you look back, there'll be, so, oh yeah, there's so 2000, like so 70, so 50, so 60, so 80, so 90, so 2000, right? And of course, you don't see it at this point in time, but looking back from the future perfect tense, right? And your project will be marked by certain type of use of techniques, certain type of a prevalent stylistic morphology and so forth, certain kind of interests, and that they are, they'll be registered in the history of the evolution of architectural propositions. And not too many people can think in those terms. And in fact, not too many people want to think in those terms, wish to think in those terms. And my point is that it is necessary to think in those terms. And especially you are deploying computation. And computation has ushered in another whole new paradigm. And this image is a symbolic representation of the universe by John Wheeler in terms of bits, zeros and ones. And so far, the physics of matter, the universe has been privileging the physics of energy and matter, but not of information. And only in the last 20 years or so, scientists have begun to think the universe in terms of information. And John Wheeler, who is in his 90s, if he's still alive, I'm not sure. He used to teach at Princeton. He's a teacher of very famous scientists, the likes of Richard Feynman and so forth, among numerous others. But he was the first guy here in America within the scientific community to propose the idea that nature of the universe can be reduced to, can be conceptualized in terms of information. And this is his image of it. And so out of that, a new paradigm in science is that, and this is a controversial notion, that the universe is a form of computation. That the universe is a computer. And of course, when you're designing using Maya, using dynamical systems, you don't think about these things. It's almost trivial, almost irrelevant, right? But these are the philosophical, larger implications about the kind of methodology, the kind of technique, the kind of instrument that you're deploying. And there are a number of people who hold on to this idea that the universe is a form of computation. If Leibniz were alive today, he would also be in those terms. In fact, Leibniz is responsible for coming up with a conceptual idea about computers. But at that time in the 17th century, he didn't have the resources. Now, I'm telling you all these stories, all these ideas, all these concepts, right, to convey the fact that architecture is not just simply the use of tools, but there's a history of the making of tools, history of concept, mathematics, physics, science, religion, philosophy that goes into the construction of these objects. So one cannot just look at a building and just reduce it to just purely in terms of functional accommodations or performative, now the catchword, right, the performativity of the building. But where, in fact, you know, if you take, for instance, I'm sort of a little bit ahead of my slides. This is a famous image, right? But if you, if a Martian were to arrive here today, right, it took, if they, all the time that they have take, have, they can take with them is a Coca-Cola bottle. What would they do? And don't ask me why they can only bring back to Mars, right? Hypothetically speaking. Just a Coke bottle. What would they do? Mind you, they would take that Coke bottle, deconstruct it, right? And trace back all the chemistry atoms, right? All the physical and material properties of that glass, geometry, topology, what have you, right? Ink. And then they would then, based on that analysis, then they would reconstruct and judge and synthesize the complexity and sophistication and the intelligence necessary in the construction of such an artifact as a Coca-Cola bottle. And through that, that they know that, yes, these alien beings, because we are aliens to them, right, that they have this level of sophistication and intelligence to be able to have the knowledge to construct a Coca-Cola bottle, which to ours is only a dollar, worth a dollar, but to them it's worth more than a dollar. But it is an evidence, it's an artifact, it's of intelligence in the physical universe, and that there's a certain level of, you know, they have attained a certain level of intelligence, and that they can manufacture such an artifact called a Coca-Cola bottle. Now, what about the British Museum? Take all the artifacts in the British Museum. You can fill up an encyclopedia. Right? So it is in that larger context of the library, of the universe, of knowledge that Borges talked about, right? Also, Foucault talks about that architecture is situated. It's an artifact of intelligence. And that we are now at the critical threshold where there's a convergence of computation, conceiving the universe in terms of bits, zeros and ones. As a matter of fact, zeros and ones are invented by Leibniz. I hope you can bear with me. I'm still telling you a little story into the labyrinth. And you might find it difficult to, well, actually, I shouldn't be so arrogant. But this is a food for thought, okay, at the end of the day. So there's, at the point, there's a convergence of computation and genetics. And that has profound implication for humanity, especially with the completion of the Human Genome Project. And for the first time, we have in our hands, as a knowledge, right, the complete sequence of men, women. And that by manipulating certain genes, we can infect, if it is fashionable, doctor, doctor, give me a tail. Don't laugh. I mean, really, you have seen images of rabbits with green fur, chickens without feathers. That are genetically sort of, manipulated. And so in our genes, right, in our DNA system, it has a capacity to grow tails, but through evolutionary development and adaptation, that function has been inhibited. But what if it is fashionable, let's say, to have zebra skin on your body? I mean, who knows, though, given what people do to their body these days, all kinds of things, right? And it's not unreasonable and unfathomable to imagine that such things would not be possible. They say, doctor, doctor, give me your zebra skin. And who knows what else, through some genetic mutation. So that's why earlier on, going back to what I was saying, that you are perhaps your children are the last generation of thoroughbred Homo sapiens. Now, if that is the case, it's quite plausible, in fact, some crazy mad scientist somewhere in Korea or who knows where, maybe perhaps Burma, where I came from, right? If there's some crazy scientist over there, would in his secret laboratory, even though Bush said no stem cell research, but in his secret laboratory, he would concoct some kind of a mutant, hybrid, grotesque biological species, right? And then suddenly, after 10 years old, he would show it to the world through the New York Times. If that is the case, what would happen to architecture? What are the implications of architecture? What are the implications of capitalism? Because capitalism have already abducted biotechnology. And in fact, you know, the corporations are at the forefront. They have abducted computation. They have hijacked computation. And the conversion of computation and biotechnology is going to be bizarre, to say the least, and that we are literally moving towards the brave new world, and you better be prepared for it. And if that is the case, what would happen to architecture? What is architecture? See? It's not so simple. So if earlier on I said that architecture is a subset of anthropology, that it's an extension of man, is a domestication of the, you know, sort of spatial and environmental and cultural information that surround us, encompass us virtually, so that we feel at home, that we habituate ourselves in that context, virtual reality. Because architecture has always been virtual reality. Right. I mean, both physical and virtual at the same time. So what would happen to architecture with the convergence of computation and biogenetics? And this is a real, I'm not making such speculative question to you, proposing speculative questions to you, but it is a real and fundamental question. Whether you choose to address the questions, up to you. I'm not saying that you should, but if you're concerned with the history of architecture, with the history of human civilization, the history of man, the history of possible architecture, that if architecture is the construction of possible world, then one has no choice, at least for me, but to think about these terms. And the future is not all that rosy, right? We are fantastic people in biotechnology and in sciences. They're quite optimistic to some degree, right? They can find a cure for cancer and all kinds of disease and so forth, no doubt. But of course, another aspect is that the unspoken aspect of computation is that not just about coming up with complex, novel instruments for fabrication and all that stuff, or you know, to compute abstract mathematical propositions, or to render photorealistic renditions about architecture, but the underlying aspiration of computation, and this is quite profound also, just as profound as biological system, is that it is the embodiment, whether it be robotic systems or some other kind of abstract machines, right? The embodiment of artificial intelligence and artificial life. That is the ultimate aim of computation, information processing of the universe. It was Tommaso Toffoli, who teaches at Boston University, he says that when you compute, when you're using your software program, when you're using your Mac, Intel, whatever, right, we are just merely taking a ride in this gigantic ocean of information processing that the universe is already engaged in. And so to that extent, of course, this notion is based on the universe as a form of computation. And also Wolfram agrees with that, and Gregory Chaitin, who invented algorithmic information theory, I don't know how many of you are aware of it, agrees with it, and both of whom, their whole antithetical position with regard to the theory of information, and I'm not going to go so far at this moment in time, because otherwise I'm going to venture into other areas, but their favorite philosopher is Leibniz. And so I think computation is a fundamental sort of a paradigm, and not just simply a technique or method or instrument for you, just like a car or whatever, some kind of instrument for you to do something, but in fact, computation is taking place already everywhere. And now they are talking about computational monads. What about computational pills, just like you take Tylenol? So that information in terms of nanobots will travel through your blood. You take a little computational pill, right? Through your body, through your bloodstream, and augment, sort of like Johnny Mnemonic, right? The information processing capacity of your brain. Of course, these ideas, of course, you can say that, you know, they're so far-fetched in the future, it is irrelevant. But the gist of the matter is that it is computation. It has to do with the phenomena of computation, and these are the possible future that we can imagine. And so if any of you think that, okay, we don't need to think about it in these terms, fine. You know, you do whatever you want to. I'm sure you have good reason to do that. But for those of you who want to take architecture and expand the boundary condition of architecture, the limits of architecture, extend it beyond that, and I think you hold a sudden, I don't want to go so far to say that an ethical imperative is to think about possible futures. Because after all, the construction of possible has to do with the construction of possible futures also, right? The future of architecture, the futurity of architecture, and not just the present, not just the past, but the future is the domain of what the next generation is going to encounter. And of course, we cannot predict ahead of time. But nonetheless, we can, like Alan Kay said, that we can invent possible futures based on conditions that are present, but you know, projecting into the future, and not just simply solving problems of the present. Now, dealing with reality, computation is discrete, deals with zeros and ones, right, bits, information is bits, but the continuous continuity, like calculus that you're using, deploying, even though you use Maya, right, but you don't know what the conceptual logic, mathematics that goes into the making of Maya is based on the mathematics of continuity. And these are two opposing approaches. And I'm sure for those of you who use polygons and NURBS, they're not so easily reconcilable, right? But software designers make it so easier for you with subdivision and so forth. But fundamentally, these are conceptual as well as mathematical problems. And so in physics also, we realize that particles come in terms of discrete packets of energy, and at times they come in wave patterns. We know that. And these are some of the fundamental paradoxes of reality, in this case, physics. And the same thing is true. You know, one can say that with a bit of over-exaggeration, that the history of architecture, of course, today I'm making a lot of generalization because I have to, in order to talk about architecture in the broad sense of the term, in order to open up, to crack the limits and boundary conditions of architecture itself. Because here, in any school, not just here or there, I mean, this is a fantastic school, don't get me wrong, because I'm speaking these terms, the projects that I saw in the last 2 days are not good, they're fantastic, okay? But I just want to open up the little egg yolk, that egg that you are operating within. And same thing is true with Colombia, Pratt, Barcelona, so forth. And so, there are limits to computation, the discrete and continuous, right, how we operate in that context. And I gave a project at Columbia a year ago called Hilbert's Hotel. Hilbert's is a German mathematician in all about the 20th century. He came up with the concept of the infinite hotel. And students are asked to address the concept of infinity. Traditionally, the concept of infinity is relegated to the concept, it's almost isomorphic with the concept of God. If you're talking about the infinite, then you're talking about God. But with Cantor, and which again, Badiou has shown that there is an excretion of the concept of infinity away from God. So that the concept of infinite is just pure mathematical secular concept, to use what Francois Roche was talking about, the profanation of the concept, of a concept, away from theological foundations. And it's necessary to think in terms of the generic architecture, the generic, as Badiou defined it. In fact, it's not an invention of Badiou, but Badiou got it from set theory from a mathematician by the name of Paul Cohen. If you know the history of recent mathematical history, they're profound concepts that are deployable, that can be used for architecture, at least not, so, if not in terms of pragmatic terms, but in terms of theory, in terms of way of sort of conceptualizing about the nature of architecture itself. And of course, we have discrete and the continuous, what Deleuze called, he used different terms, the smooth and the striated. And in fractal systems, you have discrete systems, and you can use fractal systems to simulate or emulate natural systems, such as mountain, landscape, and so forth. And of course, continuous systems are the one that you guys have been such a strong predilection for fluid dynamics. And ultimately, continuous systems are based on, in mathematical equations, partial differential equations, and which in turn is based on real numbers as opposed to integers, meaning that real numbers are based on decimal systems, infinitesimal systems, and they are non-computable, conceptually, theoretically speaking, all right? But at some point, you know, the software programs, you know, cut it off. Okay, we can only calculate up to 16-point floating calculation, 32, what have you, and they give you an approximation, generalization of the approximation about what that information is. But theoretically, it's deep down. It goes all the way to infinity. I am interested in incorporating the concept of infinity into a theory of architecture. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know how to do so explicitly yet. And up to this point, I've been thinking architecture in terms of the construction of possible worlds, but can we expand that concept to include the domain of the infinite? Not as God, not as a reference, because traditionally, theologically, architecture has been, you know, in relation, in tension to the divine, so to speak, the secular concept of the infinite. And it is necessary. And that necessity is not so apparent to us, but in time, I think, it is necessary to counteract the notion of computation. Because computation is based on discrete integers, and the concept of infinity is based on decimal real numbers, and they are antithetical to each other. But thought has the capacity to think the infinite. It was Descartes, you know, the French philosopher in the 16th century, says that how can a finite mind such as a human mind can come up with a concept of the infinite? And of course, Descartes' response was that, yeah, God created man, and therefore he implanted this concept within the human mind itself. And therefore I think I am, and therefore I as a thinking being can think about the concept of the infinite, which is an extension of that notion of thought itself. But in the case of Bourdieu, he has valorized and addressed this notion of the infinite as a kind of a construct of, as part of the construction of a system of thought, as a system of thinking. And in fact, the concept of the infinite is a foundational concept that is necessary for the concept of freedom itself. Most of us talk about freedom, but we don't talk about, you know, what is the foundation of freedom? You can have freedom, because freedom in a purely conceptual term is the without limitation, without constraints, right? But as such, it is founded on the concept of infinite freedom. But of course, there's no such thing as infinite freedom, but nonetheless, philosophically, conceptually, one has to incorporate that idea, is of necessity, it entails the concept of infinity. Now, coming back home to the plane of immanence, according to you, Deleuze's term, here on Earth, we have forests and jungles, and one of the models that we use, especially now that we are deploying biogenetic systems, is the concept of the forest, the jungle. Meaning the jungle is not just simply a natural phenomenon, but it's also a political term. Meaning that multiple species coexist at the same time without any kind of a structural order, or rather without any kind of ready-made structure. It's an ecology, it's a cohesive, right? It's a self-organized system par excellence. So part of the intention of using these kind of autonomous systems, interactive systems, complex data systems, is to model the equivalent, the analog of what a jungle is already is already manifesting itself. And so if we take that notion, of course, in the jungle, you have genetic systems, all kinds of species. Every species has its own genetic code. So it's not that I'm just trying to propagate an ideology, but it is a fact of existence, a fact of nature, a fact of mathematical system, and not just mathematical, but it's a logical system. Genetic is a logical term. And it so happened that biology discovered it first, and so becoming a biological concept, where in fact, pure, if you think in terms of purely conceptual term, it is a logical concept. And so on Earth, we have four regimes of matter, solid, liquid, gaseous, and plasma, which is the most abundant in the physical universe, but the least abundant. And in terms of landscape, we have the forest, the jungle, we have the liquid, the oceanic, underwater, and the desert. But if you include mountains, they're part of the jungle, right? And in each domain has a different kind of architecture. In the desert, it gave rise to a different kind of architecture. In the jungle, it gave rise to a different kind of architecture. And of course, oceanic under liquid space, because we are not there, but there's a different kind of architecture, meaning that there's a book called Hypersea. It's a fantastic book. I forgot the name of the authors, but it talks about life, the emergence of life from the sea to land. Whereas underwater, there's no need for infrastructures. But once you are on land, because the human body and all other species are 70% liquid, right? You have to construct bridges, you have to construct roads, you have to construct all kinds of infrastructure network systems in order to transport energy, matter, food, whatever, you, information. And the latest incarnation of that is the internet. And here, I'm showing the jungle as a model, not to imitate, but conceptually, so that multiple species, multiple beings, multiple architects can coexist at the same time within the same symbiotic ecology. And here, you would have to qualify the concept of genetic with symbiogenesis. And of course, we are talking far ahead of what we are capable of doing. And that's what we need to do. We need to think. And so far, all I've been doing is just to explain the thought of architecture, to look at nature, to look at abstract systems, to look at the concept of the meaning of the term architecture, that if architecture is no longer, if we don't project ourselves as the expression of architecture, right, then you're like in the jungle. No single species expresses itself or dominates politically or pragmatically. And then the concept of nature that we have, of course, we have no universal concept of nature. Everybody has a different concept of nature. You come from India, you have a different concept of nature. If you come from Mexico, Europe, or wherever, a different kind of mythology of nature. But nonetheless, all of them share one fundamental fact, that we have man, we have nature. Man, what is artificial and what is natural? And for the longest time, the distinction holds, what is artificial and what is natural. And now, with the deployment of biological systems, with natural systems, with fluid dynamics, that distinction is blurring. We're imitating natural systems. And we're imitating biomorphic systems, right? And the tendency is to lapse into some kind of imitation game, so that we make buildings that look like biological organisms, we make buildings that look like shaped like monsters, you know, biological system or species and so forth. So that kind of biomorphic imagination is alive. And it becomes a problem for me. I'm against kind of biomimetic approaches, any kind of imitation game. But to some extent, it is necessary in terms of feeding your imagination, right? We look at the world and we're inspired by a lizard, we're inspired by a lizard, I mean, butterfly and so forth. Yes, but the more important aspect is not just to imitate the shape of these systems, the patterns of these systems, the body of these kind of figures, but to really go into the nature of systems that gave rise to these type of organism having a certain kind of a bodily manifestation. And so we are at a point in time where the distinction between man and nature, what is artificial and what is natural, is breaking down. And that's the purpose of this image. So what have we have spoken so far? Architecture is the construction of possible worlds, and if you incorporate the notion of the generic infinite, then you have to extend the concept of architecture beyond that of the domain of the constructability, and that we are going through a phase whereby there's a convergence of computation and genetics, and the implication for it is profound with the completion of the Human Genome Project. And so it is plausible, is it possible for the first time in the history of architecture to think in terms of genetic architecture? I hope you follow my reasoning. And to that extent, Le Corbusier said that man or architecture is a machine for living, and that the machine is in the garden. Now, the new idea, and it in fact is the title of a book called Garden in the Machine, the simulation. All of these things are garden in the machine in Shanghai. They're generated, like sort of like, if I may sort of stress the metaphor, in vitro fertilization of architecture. How about that? Petri dish, architecture grown in the Petri dish, except that Petri dish is your Macintosh, your PC, right? But nonetheless, all of that information processing is going on over there. And you, outside of the system, outside of the box, the black box, right, begin to sort of manipulate certain kind of a shape, form, parameters, constraints, and then it would output these things, right? And you print it, and you think there is no natural system involved in it, but where, in fact, computation is a physical process. And a lot of people who think that they talk about ecology of computation and so forth, well, no, the material ecology, but where in fact they are biomimetic notion. Because the computer, the hardware, is a physical system. It takes energy, it generates entropy to erase one bit of information. And that's a fact that's proven in computer science. So they don't talk about the ecology of computation, they talk about ecology of material system, which is a referential, imaginary reference that exists outside of computation itself. And that's why I'm against that notion. And that the better, the more you focus on the intrinsic properties and intrinsic capacity of these systems and look at them as if they are another animal, that you're not out there to domesticate that cat. Let the cat be what it can be. Don't domesticate your dog in terms of giving a human name, right? Let it be in the wild, so to speak. That is the truest or closest to its own sort of intrinsic wild nature of what a dog is like, the dogginess of a dog. I'm not saying that there's a sort of deep essence to it, but that is a dog is an expression of a certain kind of system, right? And you're not going to do it by shaping it so that it goes onto Vogue magazine. So we do architecture like as if, you know, shaping the dog, a little, you know, we do that with a little poodle, cut the hair in such a way that it can, you know, Paris Hilton can hold and take a picture for Vogue magazine. And we're the same thing, doing the same thing in architecture. It's just, you're not so, it's not so obvious or so explicit. So what have we got? Yeah, simulation, mimesis, representation. Back to what Badiou called dealing with the real, what Lacan called dealing with the real, and not just be preoccupied with the symbolic dimensions of language, of systems, or the imagination that is hooked on your own fantasy about what reality is. Right? These are secondary construct, or you know, tertiary construct, like a layer cake, like an onion. But you never get to the real. And of course, we're talking about the real. And I'm interested in the real. The real is inaccessible, according to Lacan. You can never get hold of it. That it is a hole in knowledge. You can never have complete access to it. But nonetheless, it is an elusive kind of a haunting agenda that pulls you in. And so architecture, the way I would like to see it is that it is circulating around the nature of the real, and whatever the real cannot be incarnate and embodied in physical or computational terms. And it is at that point that Badiou talks about the infinite in terms of generic procedures of the infinite, of truth, of the real. So he took Badiou's concept of the real and aligned with mathematical theory of the infinite and set theory, and then the real then becomes an orientation, a reference point that, not just a reference point having a spatial orientation that you can point to, but nonetheless an intellectual conceptual reference point where the project is in tension towards its own possible futures. And without that that reference, there's no future to architecture. All right, so I'm trying to weave through my argument. Now I better move a little faster. Here's, again, going back to what I was telling you in terms of how the machine was living. And now we're deploying computation that the machine is in the garden as opposed to a machine is in the garden for Corbusier. And now we have a notion, an inversion of that, right? Garden and the machine. And we have always been, not just talking about these machines, but as a kind of a subjectivity. Subjectivity is a kind of a fiction, but so real, so close, so in touch with your own sort of bodily sentiment, some kind of a psychosomatic drama, right, that you're elevated to the concept of the real, but where in fact, you know, there are other kinds of processes. So my other advice, suggestion to you guys, because most of you guys are students, I suppose, is find ways to deal with the system on its own terms, on its own intrinsic properties, on its own intrinsic capacity, and let it be what it can be. And then if it doesn't do that, at the end of the day, yes, no doubt, we still have to modulate and we still have to somewhat interact in a kind of manipulate it to some degree. But to do so within the context of whereby you don't go over the threshold where you completely domesticate it according to your own criteria, whatever that may be. And only then do we have a chance to address the concept of symbiogenesis. And only then can we have an equivalent model similar to that of a jungle. Okay, I'm not saying that you should do that, but if you choose to do, if it interests you, then these are the approaches, these are the plausible approaches to another way of looking at architecture, another way of redefining architecture. And I will hope that each of you hold the responsibility to redefine what is architecture. And don't take the dictionary concept of what architecture is. According to the Webster English Dictionary, it says that architecture is the construction of buildings, the art of making buildings. But of course, it's not true, it's not wrong, but it's far more than that. And I think it is the task of yourself as an education for your own being, as a human being, right, that you need to interrogate, question, and expand the concept of architecture. And maybe perhaps for yourself, you don't have to tell people, you don't have to write books what architecture is and what you've chosen to do. And so earlier I mentioned the convergence of computation and genetics. I'm not making these things up. These are in the newspaper. Read the New York Times, the London, whatever the newspaper here is. To the extent, Americans are provincial, I myself included. I don't even know the name of the London Times, is that? Excuse me. So we're moving to the brave new world of architecture, okay? So these are just a hint, an indication, early traces. And I think you should be concerned. I feel that you should be concerned with the implications of possible futures of architecture. I haven't shown you my work yet. Or maybe I'm wrong. I've been showing you planets. And of course, you know, in that movie, 2001, right? You know, the computer HAL, artificial intelligence, right? Outsmart one of the astronauts. And according to many people, I don't really have to name names, one of whom is, what's this guy's name? The guy who wrote the book, The Singularity is Near. Kurzweil, yeah. He's so optimistic. Listening to someone like Kurzweil and listening to me, it's like far apart, right? The level of speculation, informed speculation that these guys are engaged in is astounding. And you compare to architecture, they'll laugh at you. Deans of schools of architecture will laugh at you, as sometimes they do at me. It's true. It's a risky business, right? It's just like, is that the title of some projects I saw the other day? It's called Risky Business. Oh, no, it was a lecture at Columbia. Okay, it's called Risky Business by Juan Herreros. Well, so when you are dealing with expanding the concept of the traditional conventional paradigm of architecture, you are in the no man's land. And yet, without you guys, right, especially young people, that's where the future of architecture is. It is in your hands. And it is to that end that I'm here today sharing thoughts about architecture. Maybe you have heard it somewhere else. Maybe you have read it in the newspaper. Right? These news that I'm talking about is everywhere. But we need to bring them back to architecture. We cannot be just indifferent. Because whatever is happening out there in the universe, in the cultural universe rather, in the political universe, in the social universe, economic universe, technological universe, it affects architecture. And so in that sense, you know, for instance, in this case, robotic science. Here we're still, again, this is another indication, robots are made in the image of man, or in this case, women. So there's a kind of, such a primordial drive, desire, impulse to make things outside of yourself, like this mirror image that Francois Roche was talking about in terms of Lacan. of course, in the case of Lacan, it's a self-synthesizing sort of, you know, cohesion about the ego, the id. Again, here coming back to genetic architecture, for the first time we can think about growing building, growing architecture, and some of the sci-fi writers are in that train of thought. And in fact, some biologists at MIT are already doing research investigation in the attempt to grow buildings. In this case, they have a very primitive, naive concept of architecture. They're growing huts, basing using plants. You can manipulate these plants in order to grow into a hut, a primitive hut. So people out there are already thinking these terms. So architecture discipline is highly provincial. Any discipline is highly provincial, right? And by their own sort of default nature. And I think one has a responsibility to go outside of that, to go beyond that, and incorporate conditions that are outside of it into architecture so that it becomes part of architecture itself. Because after all, architecture is part of the construction of a possible world, and that nothing is completely detached from everything else. And so the embodiment of artificial intelligence, not just in terms of robotic systems, but also the embodiment of intelligence within your own brain. And people like Wolfram are talking about a number of people downloading software, just like in the movie Matrix. And I was one time navigating on the internet on the concept of, not on teleportation, but on quantum physics. And I, you know, as you navigate, it leads to somewhere else, right? And it took me to this IBM research team headed by Charles Bennett, who's a profound scientist. And he's right now at IBM working on quantum computation, which I've not addressed yet. And he, I'm just making sort of footnote to Bennett. He also came up with the concept of logical depth, and which I referred to earlier in terms of Coca-Cola bottle, which I'll get to it. What is the logical depth? That's the term that he invented. What is the logical depth of a Coca-Cola bottle? How complex, how intelligent, how sophisticated must a civilization be in order to invent such an artifact? And so the embodiment of artificial intelligence and downloading software, he said that, you know, there's, in quantum physics, there's a phenomenon called quantum teleportation. For those of you who have kept up with physics, you know, sort of like sending fax, right? You send fax from A to B. B is in another remote region. A has a encoder. You decode the information, you put the image, decode it, and then there's a link, whether it be wireless or cable. And then the other side has a decoding machine, and then it decode and then reconstitute the image. And so, oh yeah, this is, you know, so-and-so, Britney Spears. But in quantum teleportation, there's no sending of information. By virtue of the fact that there's a phenomenon called quantum entanglement, this is also crucial to what I'm thinking in terms of the construction of possible worlds, because in fact, quantum computation made it possible to think in these terms from a physical science point of view. So to every particle, I don't know if I'm boring you guys or not, but just bear with me, okay? It's not too often that you hear these crazy ideas in terms of architecture, right? It's not just shape-shifting and putting some stuff. I can do it very easily, mind you. I chose not to do it, which I will do. It's part of my desire. Where am I? I'm here, therefore I am. Okay, so we're talking about teleportation. It's a strange and quirky behavior of quantum phenomena that to every particle, there's a counterparticle, as some of you probably know, right? And if you manipulate this one particle, you are inherently manipulating the other particle, which is separate across vast spaces and distance that even sort of exchanging information between at the speed of light would not be able to be able to accommodate that. But so scientists came up with this notion of teleportation, just like in Star Trek, right? Captain Spock went into a chamber, disappear. Captain Spock pop up, or maybe perhaps better still, Britney Spears went into the chamber, disappear, and Britney Spears came out on the other side of the remote universe, in another galaxy, so far removed that no, even light cannot even fathom in this short space of time. And so the question, the theoretical question that Charles Bennett raised was, is this architecture? No, I'm just kidding you. But it really, I mean, is this architecture? The machine that reconstitutes Britney Spears on the other side as the architectonic structure that is built into it. But the point that Charles Bennett asked is this, that if Britney Spears that came out on the other side of the galaxy, right? Does she still have or retain her own experiences, memory, history, desire, taste, dispositions, all these amorphous and elusive and qualitative criteria, right? Because computation has to do with quantitative manipulation of data. And so if there is some kind of a resemblance of cohesion and consistency that between the two Britney Spears, then there must be such a thing. There must be some kind of a soul phenomena going on, he says. Of course, for lack of a better term, and I'm not kidding you, the concept of soul was the term that he uses. Okay, so now we are really at the edge of speculation, which is not so new in terms of thought. Because in the medieval time, these monks in the monastery, they're trapped there, right? Other than just making beer and praying, they're debating among themselves, right? How many angels can they dance on the tip of a pin? Now, that idea may seem so far-fetched and so ludicrous to modern people, right? Because we know that, you know, for common people, there's what angels, first of all, angels, to think in terms of angels and souls is like a sort of medieval notion. But look, all the information, all the books that have been printed up to this point in time, since time immemorial, the first time men started inscribing in bones and scribes, right? All that information can now be compressed, theoretically speaking, in principle, to a size that is no larger than a pin. Can you imagine the Library of Congress in America, all the information that is printed, the blogosphere, the internet is exponentially increasing in terms of information. All that information can be stored on an atomic chip, no bigger than the tip of a pin, and implanted sort of like Johnny Mnemonic into your brain. Then who are you? Right? And then what if you can download all kinds of software programs, yet to be, discovered software programs, yet to be discovered function. It does all kinds of, things that are unimaginable to us at this moment in time. You'll be a genuine schizophrenic. And you can just like a multitasking in your PC, right? You can run Maya, Photoshop, word processing, who knows what, right? And simultaneously, and you can be doing that. So Deleuze's concept of schizophrenia can be also transported to or translated into computational terms in terms of hardware and software. And the body is hardware, architecture is hardware, software is intelligence. And we know that the DNA software, the DNA program in our body is a software program, and there is such a thing as DNA computing. The DNA in your body is ancient. You may be 25 years old, 30 years old, but the DNA system, the paradigm in your body is ancient. So who are you? Now, these are profound questions. If you're a philosophically minded philosopher, right, these are perplexing, undecidable questions with no ready solutions. So it is on top of all of these complicated, unheard of thoughts, right, undecidables, unknowables, paradoxes, that we construct something that we call architecture. And of course, artificial intelligence, robotic systems. Here, instead of man made in the image, there are no robots are going to make us in their own image, in time, Xbox. And they will ask their own rights, rights of the robots, right? So I think there are profound issues. What about human rights? If you think about it, it's quite problematic. The concept of human rights has to be situated within the concept of the rights of life. I don't mean the right to life as the conservative I'm making argument for, but life as such has an innate sort of a right to live. And it is in that context, the human concept of human right, and not only according to Bourdieu, the concept of human right is structured in tension only towards the finite, the human rights of the impoverished. In most cases, politically and ethically speaking, morally speaking, the human right is directed towards people, homeless people, people without nations. And they have no rights. And so the concept of human rights addressed with these concepts. But where, in fact, Bourdieu said, yes, that is not to deny that, okay, we need to help these people who are impoverished, without nations, without any kind of sovereign sort of governance. But also the other side of the equation is that human rights must be directed towards the infinite potential of human beings. And that's his argument against the conventional understanding of human rights. That's first proposed by Lyotard and then Bourdieu. So it is in that context, the rights of architecture, the relation of the human being in relation to architecture, so that not to domesticate and not to sort of make architecture a mirror image of your own being. What's going on, Christian? Christian, by the way, is worked on a lot of these planetary automata. So we need to resituate the concept of human rights. You may think that I'm just sidetracking a number of issues, but I'm going to weave them back. Hegel, one of the last books that Hegel wrote called The Philosophy of Right, has to do with property ownership, property rights, and human rights. And he really establishes sort of a legal foundation, a philosophical legal foundation for the concept of rights. And I think we need to loosen that concept, the rights of architecture. So that just like Louis Conway says, what does the brick want to be? That it wants to be an arch. He's saying that, whether the, of course, in this case, the arch is useful. There's a history of, you know, performance for a human being in churches, in primitive ancient architecture. But essentially what he's pointing to is the nature of the properties of these matters, these systems, these data, to self-organize themselves. And so to do so, if you want to relinquish a bit of your control, right, then you have to allow for the rights of the other, whatever that other is. It could be systems, it could be material systems, it could be animals, it could be you name what. So again, to that extent, St. Francis, you know, within the concept of Christianity, has a role, but of course without, you know, theological underpinnings. And again, this is consistent with the notion of the architecture. One of the aspirations of architecture is a kind of a jungle. The jungle is a kind of a speculative model, not to imitate, but to simulate an equivalent reality. And it is in that context that, again, architecture is, or genetic architecture is significant. And I don't like to say this, but I am of the faith and conviction that a significant part of the future will be the synthesis of morphodynamical, my friend Bill, and morphogenetic systems. So I'm not against at all, don't get me wrong, Bill, I'm not against antithetical at all in morphodynamical system. In fact, it is imperative, it's a necessity to synthesize, because in natural system, you have this kind of a mutation and synthesis of these two seemingly dissimilar approaches. Okay, so a synthesis and reconciliation of morphodynamical and morphogenetic processes. And this is an image of pods from the movie Matrix. I'm sure most of you have seen Matrix, right? If not in the movie theater, in the TV, right? And I was so disappointed. I saw the last version after six variations, right? In one case, you know, Neo got married. Another case, you know, Neo could have been crazy man, a schizophrenic, whatever. There are infinite possible variations. But in the movie, there are only six variations. And at the end of the movie, they disclose the architect. I mean, what a disappointment. The guy could have been from SOM or KBF. I mean, the movie has quite profound, you know, speculative ideas in it. And mind you, these people who write these stories, these films, of course, they are for entertainment, but nonetheless, they are very informed. Many of these guys are very informed. So don't underestimate these ideas that you see in popular entertainment. For instance, there's a book called The Philosophy of Matrix. And also, at the same time, there's another film that came out called Existence. David Cronenberg, right? Well, the virtual reality in the world, the physical world, at some point, it's undecidable. It doesn't really matter. Of course, to some extent, that's a metaphor, both literally as well as metaphorically, because the mind, the memory, the imagination that you have is already virtual to begin with, right? And not talk about your physical body. And so what are we left with? Some kind of organic architecture. And again, the term organic, one has to be careful. There's a history of organic architecture. This is not the first time that we think about organic architecture, not just in terms of right and in the 19th, 18th century, but organicism, organization. An organ as conceptually is a body of thought. An organ as a musical instrument. An organ as part of the word that, you know, that's in the term organization. And they are all part and parcel of the same thing. So when we say organic architecture, we are also simultaneously talking about architecture as a musical instrument, architecture as a biological organism, a form of organization, and ultimately as a form, a body of thought. And so I am interested now, steadily but slowly, I'm sort of inching towards showing some of the examples, which is already on that on the plasma screen, or developing a computational monadology of architecture based on the Leibniz concept of the monad. And for Leibniz, a monad is literally what he refers to as a metaphysical point. At that time, he doesn't have a clearly formulated concept of the infinitesimal. So he said, okay, just like the Democritus and those guys, there's an atom of existence, a unit of existence. But he hypostatized it into a metaphysical point. But for us, that is true if you think in terms of a point from the calculus of continuity, right? Leibniz, along with Newton, those two guys are responsible for inventing calculus. Conceptually speaking, calculus as a mathematical system is based on the concept of infinitesimals. And you ask yourself, how big or small is an infinitesimal? Something that is larger than zero, but smaller than any numbers that you can think of. Okay? And these are uncomputable, non-computable. And it is based on this concept. In set theory, Georg Cantor in the late 19th century came up with this hypothesis called the continuum hypothesis. Because in continuity, because there's no gap, no matter how small these little infinitesimal points are, right? Because otherwise it will not be continuous, it will be discrete. It's just that the space between these infinitesimal points is so small that you cannot sort of conceptualize. And even up to this day, the continuum hypothesis, as proposed by Georg Cantor in the, maybe that's a resolution for the continuum hypothesis, is still undecidable. It's profound issues. I would suggest all of you to read Badiou's magnum opus up to this point called Being an Event. He talked about these issues. So I'm interested in developing computational monadology, and it is from that standpoint, right, that architecture is the construction of possible worlds. I'm coming back here. And that the planet that we live in is just the only, it's not the only planet. The possible worlds that we can generate, both internally as well as externally, and the wireless interaction exchange of information, right? Because right now they are developing the internet into a second order phase transition, what they're referring to as the global brain, or what is now also known as cloud computing. So the internet, as opposed to just simply composed of servers, would become processing engine. So you have, imagine, massive number of information processing taking place all over the globe, right? So you don't use your PC or Macintosh, but information processing will be relegated onto the global brain. And architecture, mind you, will be very different, and you have to think, act, design very differently in that terrain where it will be populated by artificial life and artificial intelligence. And so the new model, at least according to Wolfram, that based on his, a theory called the principle of computational equivalence, and I'm quoting him from his book called A New Kind of Science, he says that all processes, whether be those occur naturally out in nature, in the universe, or those instantiated by human beings, like Maya, software, what have you, they are all computational processes. They are equivalent. And of course, that term is also based on the concept of Turing principle, which I'll speak about a little later. But again, here, coming back to John Wheeler, he says that it's, right, the Socratic question, what is it that Socrates asked in the 500 BC, even scientists are now grappling it from bit. We can construct reality from bits of information. And according to John Wheeler, he says that in this famous article, you can get even downloaded free on the internet called It From Bit. Type in Google, It From Bit by John Wheeler. It's a fascinating piece. And this is where I got that image of the digital bits in terms of a sphere. He says that every bit in the physical world has at bottom an immaterial source and explanation that is information theoretic in origin. Every item in the physical universe, including architecture, the architecture of bits, that if Mies van der Rohe says that architecture is how you arrange two bits together, now the new paradigm is that architecture is how you arrange two bits of information together. And if you have more information, more bits, and how these information organize and interact with each other, of which cell automata is just but one example, one paradigm, autocatalytic system is another paradigm, Brownian motion is another paradigm, or what they're now referring to as Brownian computers, and how they self-organize through autocatalytic interaction into some kind of a order out of chaos, so to speak, into some kind of organization. You know, do you call that architecture? Now, this might amaze some of you, that we know that according to modern science, which is a kind of a mythology, I'm not saying that by terming it mythology that it is false, I'm not suggesting that, but because some scientists told us that it is so, we think that the scientific community thinks that, oh yeah, it's true, then we also think it's true. It's in the New York Times. So at the Big Bang, there's only one bit of information. How bizarre is this, isn't it? At the Big Bang, at the origin of the physical universe, there's only one bit of information. And out of the bit, the universe is a generative system, by the way. The universe is a generative system. And not only any generative system, the universe is a genetic system. That out of that one bit of information, the universe has expanded to the point now, at this moment in time, the universe is 10 to the power of 90 bits. So you ask yourself, how big is a JPEG file of the physical universe? Okay? Notwithstanding the specific idiosyncrasy of compression into JPEG file or TIFF file, whatever you, but nonetheless, it must contain 10 to the power of 90 bits, and it is still expanding. And if you're eating, wasting energy, right, you're expanding. If you're having sex, having procreation, you're expanding the number of bits in the physical universe. As I'm speaking to you, I'm expanding the number of bits in the physical universe. So this is an information theoretic conception of the physical universe. And so increasingly, we are beginning to think in terms of computation as the construction organization of bits. And that, at bottom, is information theory. But again, if architecture is a construction of possible worlds, not just in terms of physical buildings and hardware, but also the embodiment of hardware and software, and also one can speak in terms of software purely in terms of information, the architecture of information. And right now, increasingly so, the architecture of information is taking more and more significance over the architecture of matter and energy. And there are many people, a lot of my colleagues, including my students, they're still talking about material system, material ecology, of as if a kind of mimetic representation comes from material system, where in fact they don't take into consideration that computation is itself a material system. On that aspect, you may want to read a computer scientist by the name of Rolf Landau. He died a few years ago. He was a research scientist at IBM. He was pivotal in the science and entropy of energy, of thermodynamics of information processing. He wrote a paper called Information is Physical, which is crucial to conceptualize computation in terms of material processes, and that in computers generate heat, right? But also when you erase, when you delete, it generates heat. And right now, there's such a thing as reversible computation. And some, of course, at this stage, it's still very undeveloped. But the implications are profound. Reversible computation do not dissipate any energy. And of course, with computation, but the dream of humanity, humankind, is to get hold of the code of existence, the code of reality, or what scientists would say, the theory of everything. Equal, the equivalent of equal MC squared, that would explain everything exists, everything that exists, the physical universe, the future of the universe, whether it's going to be an open-ended universe or it's a closed universe, that's in brain theory, whether it's going to interact with other universes and create other kinds of big bangs. But quantum physics is the one that tells us that, yes, maybe, perhaps, and this is not the first time that humanity has come up with the idea of a plurality of possible worlds. Right? Copernicus discovered and shattered the oldest Aristotelian Ptolemic cosmology, a closed cosmology, into an infinite universe. And the French philosopher of science has written a book called From the Finite to the Infinite Universe. And so we are going through the equivalent of a second Copernican revolution, for lack of a better term, in quantum physics, which is still controversial. But guys like David Deutsch at Clariton Laboratory, Clariton's at Cambridge or Oxford University. David Deutsch is involved in the attempt to build the first quantum computer. And mind you, these guys think that once you have quantum computers, which is different from classical computers, all of these computers that we have now, right, they are based on classical model of computation, which is theoretically based on the Turing machine, named after Alan Turing, the British mathematician after the war. Right? So there's a history. It's good to know. I remember the reason I got into the subject is that I bought my first computer, Silicon Graphics, in 1992 or 3. And I bought a P. Armin Lake to get an Alias software. And Greg Lynn asked me which computer to use, which computer software to buy. So, you know, get the Silicon Graphics. So Greg Lynn started using Alias modeling program at that time. So, but Greg Lynn takes on the subject, Greg, he takes on a different approach, and I take on a different approach. So, so people are trying to build the first quantum computer, and then if they can do it, theoretically they can do it. And intrinsically, the motivation behind David Deutsch is that he wants to prove that there are parallel universes, multiple worlds exist. And the argument that he gives is that if information processing occurs within computational system, right, quantum computational system, in order to output an answer, a meaningful answer, that it takes more information processing than there are bits in the physical universe. He said, where is that information processing taking place? And his answer is that in other universes, and that the other universes are interconnected at levels that are lower than quantum physics. And they are in the process of doing so, and they're quite optimistic. And so with this image, what I'm trying to get is that the dream of humanity is to come up with a theory of everything, the code, right? In the Bible, God, the word of God, but here in computation, without any kind of theological reference, it's still the software program, the code, right? The code of architecture. And software construction is all about the architecture of information. It is about the architecture of software programs, right? It is how you organize certain type of instruction set. It's all about organization. And to that extent, it's an instruction set for the construction of possible architecture, except that in this case, you know, a certain type of function. And with regard to In the history of ideas about pertaining to the search for the quest, or rather the quest for the code, in the contemporary time, there are two opposing views, one of whom is Stephen Wolfram, who thinks that the universe can be generated from a code as simple as a one-dimensional cell automata, something equivalent of rule 110. And of course, that idea is not new. God, I'm taking so much time. Okay, I'll try to speed it up. That idea is not new. Leibniz already came up with this concept called the principle of sufficient reason. He said, to every cause, there's a reason. And so Wolfram said that, yes, that reason is something equivalent. Of course, Wolfram believed that the universe is a form of computation, and specifically a cellular automata, and he's not the only one. And there's another scientist by the name of Ed Fredkin, who came up with a philosophy called digital mechanics. He was, in fact, the first one to propose that the universe is a form of cellular automata. So Wolfram believed that the code of the universe is something of the order of rule 110 in cellular automata. But on the other end of the pole, someone like Gregory Chaitin, who invented a new field, the complexity algorithmic information theory. Type in Gregory Chaitin, okay? Chaitin. Fascinating stuff. He says that you cannot prove. There's no such thing as a minimal code that would encapsulate everything that exists. There's no such thing. There's no way to prove it. Even if you have a very short string, because one of the modus operandi of writing software programs is that you want to is based on the principle of what Mises called less is more. You want to write the most elegant, shortest script software program in order to generate maximum outcome. So less is more. Shorter string, generate multiple functions. And so Chaitin says that no, there's no such thing. And he has proven it mathematically. And so, but nonetheless, Wolfram is convinced. I've spoken to both of them, and they are very good friends with each other. If I speak to Wolfram, he says, you know, Chaitin, that he's wrong. If I spoke to Chaitin, he says, no, Wolfram is wrong. And so the answer still is not clearly resolved at this moment in time. But all of that has to do with the architecture of information, the attempt to come up with code, the code of architecture, the code of life, the code of existence, and so forth, and the code of possible worlds. And this is the first time I'm giving this really a lengthy, extended presentation about some of these concepts that goes into to the development of a paradigm of architecture, a theory of architecture. So many of you, perhaps you're still students, are doing architecture, not just you, but a lot of renowned architects. They're doing fantastic buildings, but they have no theory of architecture, an intuitive, a very poorly developed a theory of architecture. And this Koch bottle refers back to Bennett's notion about logical depth. You know, how complex, how sophisticated must a civilization be to construct this object? And logical depth is a profound idea, because for a given problem, there are many ways to solve that problem. Some are shorter, some are longer. Depends how you structure the information processing, how you process the data, what kind of functions that you deploy. Some faster than the other. But there's no way to predict ahead of time which is the most efficient, which is the shortest. And so it is really about the history of development of processes. And genetic system, nature has a way, optimal way to efficiently solve so many complex problems such as protein folding. But in architecture, we seldom talk about this. If I raise these architecture in terms of what is the logical depth of your project, I would have no answer. So here, coming back to the architecture of possible worlds. And the concept of possible worlds, as I mentioned earlier, was first introduced by Leibniz, so one of my favorite philosophers. And he says that there's a whole field in philosophy called modal science, modal metaphysics. And they talk about logically possible world, logically impossible worlds, and the physically impossible world, physically possible worlds, non-actual worlds, but actual worlds, right? The universe of possibility is far greater than what is out there, what is the case. So especially pertaining to the future, if the future is no longer a determination of the past, then the future is radically open, then that it is visiting all possible, phenomena that is either logically or physically possible. And then the universe of computation, the computable worlds, are a subset of all of that, which is quite small, actually. But later on, I will show you, make reference to Deutsch. And here, people in computer science would come up with possible programs, especially a computational standpoint. If you speak in terms of possible worlds, then you address in terms of possible programs and the clustering of these programs and the attempt to compress these programs. And so, the notion of compression plays a fundamental role. The compression of architecture, the compression of worlds, and the decompression of worlds, right? When you're storing information, you have a JPEG file, you're compression algorithm and a decompression algorithm. But what are the implications for architecture other than just storing in your hard disk? Just a little bit on quantum computation. The difference between quantum computation and classical model of computation is that because of the notion of superposition, there are you know, in quantum computing they use qubits as opposed to bits. A system can be in two or more of its states simultaneously. A particle can be traveling along two different paths at one time. That sometimes is particles, that sometimes is waveforms. That single photon is emitted, it bounces off the other half, and so it bifurcates into two possible realities. So a qubit is a simultaneous condensation of two states at the same time, zeros and ones at the same time. But whereas, like in the case of Turing machine, in the case of computers that we use, they are either in a zero or one state. And that creates all kinds of novelty in terms of the speed of computation, the possible outcomes that it can visit before it chooses to output a specific solution to a problem. And just this is a definition of qubits, right? Zeros and ones simultaneously coexist at the same time before it arrives at decoherence. So along these lines, I'm thinking of the architecture of possible world, architecture of the construction of possible world, and each world conceptualized in terms of a monad. A monad is not just a metaphysical point, but an aggregation of these self-similar units, just like in biological systems. And of course, all of these things is founded on a thesis in computer science. It's called the Church-Turing thesis. Alfonso Church, who was a logician in Princeton in 1936, and Turing Alan Turing. And according to the Church-Turing thesis, it says that every function which would naturally be regarded as computable can be computed by the universal Turing machine. After the Turing machine, all the computers that we have now in existence is a conceptual blueprint. I mean, the Turing machine is the conceptual blueprint of all the computers that we have. Okay, it's not a physical device, but it's an imaginary abstract machine. And this seemingly sort of a trivial statement has profound implications. And in fact, this thesis is responsible for the paradigm that says that the universe is a form of computation. And David Deutsch extrapolated this idea from a quantum computational standpoint and called it the Turing principle at the recommendation of Roger Penrose. And it says that there exists an abstract universal computing system whose repertoire includes any computation that any physically possible object can perform. An abstract universal computing system. By that, it means that the universe is a form of computation. And these are the conceptual foundations. And of course, what's going on when you compute is that here, to give you this diagram, on the left you have nature, has its own causality, and then we come up with mathematical equations, right, calculus, what have you, in order to encode or decode nature and then re-encode in mathematical terms, E equal mc squared. So that's what's happening, it's a formal system. And with the advent of computation, then we put these data into the computer and simulate the behavior of a storm, of a tornado, of a twister. And then we linked up all these systems, right? Multiple systems like the internet, machinic assemblage, to use our Deleuze terms. And still, while doing so, we still think that there's a difference between nature and society. What is natural and what is artificial. According to this French philosopher by the name of Bruno Latour, he says that we, as modern society, make this kind of bifurcation, a distinction, what Agamben called the anthropological machine operating within this division. Nature is distinct from society, and the two shall never meet. And if you look at Le Corbusier's Villa Savoy, it is en pilotis. Or even if you look at Barcelona Pavilion, that platform is semi-divine and semi-sacred, almost. With a possible exception in the case of Frank Lloyd Wright, where he tried to incorporate nature into an organic whole. There's an inside-outside dialectic going on. But according to Bruno Latour, he said in primitive society, they don't make these distinctions. Nature and man are one and the same organic reality, just like in the jungle. Okay, so he called it the pre-modern overlap. And so this divide between primitive society and modern society is this kind of distinction that presupposed by modern people, who operates according to the anthropological machine. And they have to come up with, if you read Agamben, notions about bear life, there's a conceptual distinction between what is man and what is non-human. But this is a way of hiding all that kind of carbon dioxide that we output, right? So if you look at Villa Savoye, everything's pure, white, painted white, you are lifted away from the landscape, you are sort of transcendental, on another kind of a transcendental plane, so to speak. Whereas all that garbage and all the factory, all that waste products, all the carbon dioxide that you emit is hidden away up until now. So we become conscious that the world is so bad with global warming that we begin to realize that we need to address that issue. But modernity is characterized by the work of purification and that you hide everything, all the network, all the infrastructure, all that excess of energetic output entropy hidden away. And now we are becoming much more aware of it. As I mentioned to you, DNA software program is a computing system. So the distinction between nature and artificial is breaking down, so that we're talking about hybrid systems. So the machining systems that are embedded into the body, as well as there's right now they are researching into the synthesis of flesh and metal. And very soon, I'm sure many of you have heard read this, you will not have to kill cows to eat filet mignon steak. You can have an in vitro fertilization of filet mignon steak, or New York steak for that matter, T-bone steak. It was grown in the Petri dish. And they are talking about in tissue culture engineering. And one biologist managed to build or to construct a little jacket for a mouse made of flesh. What are the implications? What are the implications of fashion, clothing? And what about embedding computing systems within biological tissue culture? What about instead of sitting on leather furniture, what about that furniture is alive? What about architecture is alive? And we are still a little bit, we still think that it's a little crazy to think these terms. It's too far irrelevant, but it's not, for me, it's not the case. Because in terms of possible future, we're talking about possible worlds, in terms of brave new worlds. And this is really there. The future is here, just like William Gibson says. It is just not widely distributed yet. So it has profound implications for architecture. And I'm occupied, preoccupied with this notion. But how do we redefine architecture? What kind of possible architecture can we imagine? What kind of a new system of imagination, methodology, techniques of producing architecture? And I think it seems to me that, especially you guys, young people, young mind, right, with such aspirations, you should be involved with these things and sort of invent the world. And the world is not just given to you, but you have, it's a part of the architecture, the ethics of architecture imperative that you have to invent the world. The best way, according to Alan Kay, to predict the future is to invent it. And of course, here again, the notion of archiving, the notion of storage. Instead of storing, like even like digital hard disk, right? Compression of information into JPEG, storing it until maybe perhaps in some cases it went corrupt. But what about the case where the universe doesn't store information, the universe doesn't have a storage house, the universe doesn't have a library, doesn't have a storage archive, but it generates information. So wouldn't it be nice if you have a generate information rather than storing information? And so again, there's an argument for architecture as part of a process cosmology based on generative systems and specifically genetic architecture. And all genetic architecture is based on this notion of self-replication, whereas you don't find that concept of self-replication in dynamical systems, but if you deploy tessellation and aggregation, of course, you are already dealing with some kind of replication and repetition, but there's no logic that would propagate them towards self-replication, and much less these atoms or cells or whatever you, or whatever tessellate units, they can interact and self-organize into complex structures, and that's very, very difficult to do. And as I mentioned earlier, a gene is a unit of hereditary information, and genetic is a propagation, a system of propagation for the hereditary information. Of course, if you follow this term strictly, then you have a linear development propagation of hereditary information, which is terrible. And so you have to conceptualize that within a distributed network, so that just like in, if you are interested in Stuart Kaufman, who's another fantastic biologist, he talked about autocatalytic systems. So you imagine these tidbits of DNA system interacting in free space. Right? And then they will self-organize into different kind of classes of functional programs, self-organizational programs. And only now we begin to think that program can be written by or self-organized into functional programs as opposed to written by human beings. Because the technology of software programming is such that at this point in time we're the equivalent of the stage where we're still making shoes and suits and clothing, one of a kind, customized. But now we have automation. And so the same thing is true with software engineering. Software that propagates and generates other software programs, and through their own internal mutation, they will generate as yet unheard possibilities. And so we're thinking in those terms now. At least we're at the beginning of a new era of architecture where we can even begin to think in these terms. And as I mentioned earlier before, the homeobox genes, the set of genes that are responsible for all morphogenesis for all 90% of individual species. And so the same kind of easier said than done, but I have intuition. I've done similar things in primitive systems with my students. How do you, basically you have multiple functions. Each function is a generative system. How do you structure them? How do you create laws of interaction among them and whether they generate any kind of meaningful structures out of that? My own work is still far behind. I'm still trying to sort of do research on it. So I'm just using my student as a kind of experiment. That's what you do as teachers. That's one of the benefits of teaching. You don't get paid too much. So, of course, this software program is readily available, the L system named after Lindemeyer, known as Lindemeyer system. I would rather see one L system project rather than using dynamical system. At least L system is one of the most, one of the primitive, simplest bifurcation system, which is genetic also. Simple codes generate complex outcome. And here, this code is very simple if you know how to read it. And, you know, biological organs are like that. Look at the heart, the kidney, the lung. It seems so complex. But I mind you, I'm also convinced, I cannot prove it at this stage in time, but the codes are very simple. Having sort of experimented with some L system and substituted systems, and how these primitive codes mutate among these codes to create more complex codes, self-organized and mutational codes. And these are diagrammatic. They are really, in some cases, as simple as tic-tac-toe. And you may laugh, like for one-dimensional cell automata is literally as simple as tic-tac-toe based on your neighborhood situations. Two whites surrounds black, do something. You know, two blacks on the left, do something, right? So they are really as simple as that. And this is something that I did earlier. Okay, this is just a mapping. So this diagram is an abstract code, generates this bifurcation branching diagram, and then the mapping on the right is an expression of that. So you have interesting, I mean, this is quite simple, but you know, if you know how to structure these diagrams, and we've done complex structure, hypercycles, and then you create complex morphology. But the task, the difficulty is to find meaningful geometries rather than creating dirty geometries. And this is one of my earlier work to use these kind of substitution systems to generate these kind of morphology. And at that time it gave me a lot of insight. Of course, geometry is still left a lot of them unresolved, but this gave me some insight for the first time at that point. I did that about 10 years ago, how you can grow structures. They are literally possible to grow structures. And I did this without the software program. I have to write the own script. I have to write the own set of rules, and then somebody script it for me. And the same system was carried out in a different context. And at the moment, I'm concerned, in the last few years, I've been sort of engaged in developing more theoretical, philosophical, conceptual, cultural aspect of these systems and the larger implications. And I'm still working towards what I refer to. I think Neil Rich a bit aware of it. What I'm referring to is demiurgic capitalism and how capitalism is going to be. I'm in no way to address this issue in any kind of a form at the point, but just to give you an indication how capitalism is going to be transformed and changed by these kind of the incorporation and embodiment of biotechnology into its own mechanism of exchange. Now, shifting the gear, I'm also interested in continuous systems, right, topology. And here, one of my interests is not topology and Seifert surfaces, and I think some students are exploring that. And I would like to see you guys explore in a more rigorous fashion, more systematic fashion, not just in terms of ad hoc. And there are a lot of potential in it. And these are not, there are, let's see, how many types are there? One, two, yeah, seven types, I think. And then you extrapolate this, the surface. So these morphology are already virtually implicit in these knots, and you just systematically extrapolate its topology. And you can just generate, you know, architecture out of it. Very simple. Stretch it, pull it, shape shift it, you know, put perforations into it, mutate all the two knots. You can generate complex, and you know, sub-replicate them. You can generate complex structures. You know, this top one, some of the students are made with both, you know, 3D printing as well as dough. You can make it out of pretzels. I was joking, if there's money to be made, you can make bread out of it. New kinds of bread morphology, if for nothing else. And so that's why I'm convinced that there's sometimes, before you design, I'm not against design. It's that you have to learn to deal with these systems, with intrinsic properties, and then find ways to constrain them and extrapolate them and transform them, rather than just doing all kinds of things. You know, for me, it's like you're just like eating food that are not properly sort of you know done. You know, or you put all kinds of things that looks good, but it may not taste good. So I think it's important to deal with intrinsic properties, intrinsic content. When people talk about content in terms of architecture, they're talking about social programmatic content. But there's such a thing as intrinsic content, extrinsic content, container and contain. and we privilege so much. And all these building projects, you're designing shoeboxes. And then you put these slices of floors. And then you come with, you put flows, movement, dynamical systems, and then you make these shapes. No, I mean, I'm sure you learn a lot, but I think there is more to it. So, and this is what, again, this is produced by L system. One of the early attempts, I wish I developed more, but I got involved. Now I'm most of, I know the logic behind better than, you know, generating these kind of design-like features. By the way, design, a note on the word design, D-E hyphen S-I-G-N, which means completely different from what we do. D hyphenate sign. Signature, sign is a semiotic term, right? So design is relinquishing subjectivity and to reappropriate subjectivity into the systems so that the subjectivity of the system as opposed to projection of the subject's own desire onto architecture. Again, I'm repeating myself in terms of domestication, but to pull yourself back, listen to the system and see what the innate possibilities are, listen to it, how you can constrain it, how you can change the parameters, you know, and then see, and it would grow on its own terms. Of course, easier said than done, but that is the gist of the matter. And then I moved to cell automata. This is one of the series, one-dimensional cell automata. And a number of you had done projects in the last 2 days based on cell automata, using three-dimensional cell automata to generate these kind of very seemingly complex morphology. I was fascinated. But at the same time, upon questioning and interrogation, okay, how many generations is this? What kind of rule sets did you use to generate these cell automata? And they don't know. And so they just, okay, oh, yeah, we can do this. Let's try it. Good. Okay, the first time, and generate these complex morphology. And that was that. Rather than trying to understand it a little bit better. And mind you, three-dimensional cell automata is highly complex. I won't even try myself. You can try, but even two-dimensional, they are so wow. Of course, that depends on the rule sets, right? You can constrain the rules in such a way that it produces simple stuff. And the two-dimensional automata are difficult. Like, for instance, the game of life has only two rules but generate complex behavior. And even at this point, I mean, there's a scientist by the name of Paul Buck. You're trying to discover, uncover self-organized criticality, the equivalent of which is like, you know, putting sand on the sand pile. You can never predict the last drop of sand that would create an avalanche. And the similar kind of behavior exists in two-dimensional cell automata, specifically in this case, the game of life. And mind you, the game of life is not just a computer game, but it is a computing system. You can use the game of life, you know how to constrain the system in such a way, and compute differential equations. And that has been proven by its own inventor, John Conway, is a mathematician at Cambridge, no, at Princeton. So any kind of software system, if it has properties of universality, it can compute anything that is computable, sort of like the universal Turing machine, if you know how to constrain the system. And anyway, so I'm doing a project, I did a project with Christian a few years back, Christian, based on one-dimensional solar automata. And there are a total of 256 rule sets. And Wolfram has made a thorough research into it. And some of these latest developments is very intriguing. And he's now getting into using cell automata to generate mathematics. And I'm interested in this a pattern, just to give you, for those of you who are not familiar with cell automata, it's a one-dimensional cell automata. One-dimensional meaning that on a tape, each tape is subdivided into squares, zeros and ones, or black and whites. Based on the neighborhood conditions, the next stage would iterate some other conditions. And so over time, you have a two-dimensional tapestry. And according to Wolfram, he says that there are only among 256 rule sets, in general, generalizing it, he said that there are only 256 possible patterns. And the first one on the top left is a homogeneous pattern, just like the desert, the ocean. Nothing happens. The same thing, boring, dull, maybe interesting, you know, inspiring, pure nothingness. And the second one is what he calls periodic patterns. The same kind of geometrical, in this case, triangles, repeat itself at a certain frequency. And the third one is chaotic patterns, completely random. No structure, no pattern, no discernibility of any kind. At every iteration, it creates all kinds of new novelty where it doesn't, even after 10,000 generations, it doesn't create any kind of discernible regularity of any kind. But he says that those three conditions are not that interesting. And of course, in biology, they have a notion called order at the edge of chaos. That is neither completely chaotic nor completely structured. But that very fine line where you are the most flexible that you find in liquid regimes, right? That's when also in terms of personal life is the most creative. You are not totally chaotic, it's out of control, nor you are completely regimented like in West Point. But that in between space is very narrow spectrum. And that's where, you know, what they refer to as order at the edge of chaos. And so rule set 110 among 200, I mean, there are a few of them actually, but specifically rule set 110 creates pattern that are order at the edge of chaos. And so I'm very inspired, I'm sure I'm not the only one, by that behavior, that kind of a pattern, order at the edge of chaos, to create architecture that would embody order at the edge of chaos. Not totally rigid, but not totally chaotic, but some of there's a nice fluency, but at the same time having an internal structure, order, interiority, as well as adaptive interaction with the context, and what are the issues, what are the forces that you bring into play. Could be the economy, could be the interest rate, you name it. And so I think I've said enough. So let me summarize. Architecture is the construction of possible worlds. And in this case, I'm just showing you one example. They're all together, so this is a mapping, right, of one-dimensional cell on a sphere. Instead of growing it on a two-dimensional surface, I grow it on a sphere. Basically, that's equivalent conceptually. So since I'm interested in computational monadology, here I'm conceptualizing the sum total of 256 rules as a computational monad, as a singularity, rather than subdividing it. So there are infinite possible variations, and you can sort of mix these rule sets, right? And you can create rules to interact with other rules. And so the consequence is quite infinite. And I can assure you, you can use this system to generate the kind of project that you do if you know how to map it, if you know how to constrain these systems. So these are some examples. Some of them are fantastic. Some of them are, you know, sort of, for some, ugly, I don't know. But for me, just to give you sort of a modeling of a certain idea more than designing buildings, but they implicitly contain conceptual issues and ideas that address the condition of architecture as a possible world. And so this is just but one manifestation of it. And I'm going to be at the showing these. I'm trying to find out if you guys hear this, spread the word. I'm trying to find a museum that would buy a total. But there are a lot of people who want to buy. So give me 10 drawings. Give me 2 drawings. I don't want to sell it. I want to sell the whole 256, not to make money, but to augment this, you know, an architecture. So, but these projects will be shown part of it